Christian Church, Burleson, Texas. My name is Kyle. I'm here to wish you a very happy Easter. This video is presented to you in hopes that you can stay home, stay smart, stay safe. We love you, miss you, and I cannot wait to see you again. So without further ado, here's Pastor Mike.
Sunday to our worship service here at First Christian Church. It's kind of peculiar looking out at empty pews, and yet I know that you are there because you have chosen to join us for this worship service. I hope that you have taken the opportunity to print the worship bulletin that was sent to you by email on Saturday, and that you have that in front of you, but never fear. If you don't have it, you'll still be able to be a part of our worship service here today. It is a peculiar experience to be in an empty sanctuary and yet to know that many of you are joining us in this worship. It is an Easter Sunday unlike any I have ever experienced. And yet, because of the constraints that are put upon us, because of our being careful in this time of dealing with the coronavirus that is sweeping our nation, I thank you for your patience and your understanding, and I hope that this service will be meaningful to you today. In our worship bulletin, we have a call to worship, and I will share that with you, and if you're following along, you are welcome to join in from wherever you are. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Each Sunday as we gather for worship, we set aside time to share joys and concerns from among and beyond our congregation. And we want to do that today, although we have to do that a little differently. We must be mindful of the public nature of this online worship service. And so I ask that we simply take a few moments in silence, trusting God with our own joys and concerns, those made known to us by others, those that you have seen in emails over the last week or two, and to lift up those concerns and needs that are known only to God. So let us take a moment and be in prayerful silence. As we prepare for morning prayer together, we can responsively participate in our call. The Spirit of the Lord is with us. Let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Great God in heaven, hear our prayers of gratitude today. On this glorious Easter, hear our songs of joyful thanksgiving and praise. We know of your boundless love for us. For you sent your only Son, Jesus, to die on a cross and to be born to new life. And because of your redeeming love, every day of our lives is a hope-filled day. filled with that which makes for wonder, joy, and peace. As we worship today in the safety of our homes because of the coronavirus pandemic, touch each of us with your Easter love. O God of love and life eternal, as Jesus appeared and spoke to Mary and to the disciples, calling them by name, restoring their faith and giving them the confidence to proclaim your saving grace and power, so come unto us and make us witnesses to the resurrection. We pray that you might enliven your whole church and cause your light to shine through us upon the whole world. God of all things possible, you have poured out your blessings on us, and we're thankful. Empower each of us now to discover the gifts within us. Empower us and encourage us as we seek to remain faithful to your command to spread the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ from our doorsteps to the ends of the earth. In the midst of this day of celebration, O God, we lift up to you those in our families, in our church, and in our community who are sick, those who are grieving, those who are afraid and alone. We especially hold before you those we have privately named to you and ask that you touch each of them with your healing hands, restoring them to wholeness according to your will. Loving God, we direct our hopes to you as we continue to pray for peace in our world, for we continue to see destruction and violence and the senseless loss of life, both close to home and in so many regions. Is a lasting peace not possible? We pray that you, O God, would speak to those in positions of power and instill in them a passion for peace, a passion so intense that they hear your voice and do those things necessary to halt the scourge of violence. We pray for the safety of our servicemen and women who bravely serve our nation in the name of peace, of freedom, and of liberty. We come before you, O God, with our praise and our thanksgiving, our prayers and our petitions, in the name of our risen Lord, the one who lives and reigns with you and the Holy One, one God, both now and always. Hear us now, O God, as we join our voices together and pray the prayer that Jesus first taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 28th chapter, the 1st through the 10th verses. Here begins the reading. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead. And indeed, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." May God add his blessing to this reading and hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. As a young child, the arrival of Easter Sunday brought thoughts of Easter baskets, of bunnies and eggs, of candy and chocolates. As a Christian, Easter should also make us think about angels. And what an entrance the angel makes on that first Easter morning. In our scripture reading today that we just heard from Matthew's gospel, we learned that on that first Easter, there was a great earthquake when an angel enters the stage of humanity from divinity's home. And then the angel rolls back the stone and sits on top of it. He sits on the stone that had entombed the world in eternal death. Yet he's sure of eternal victory. We hear that the angel's appearance was like lightning and his clothing was white as snow. What a drama when a new day is dawning, when hope seems to be rising and joy begins permeating the atmosphere. This is even better than chocolate candy and bunnies. Not everyone, though, is filled with hope by this Easter earthquake. We heard that for fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. And the angels and Jesus tell the women at two different times, "Do not be afraid." And we are told that the women left the tomb both with fear and with great joy. Not everyone experiences this day-breaking news, this new day, this new creation in the same way. The empty tomb creates a lot of fear for some. "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. A promise has been fulfilled." But the emptiness of the tomb hangs heavy in some hearts and can make fear run rampant. Ironically, for some, the empty tomb feels like an empty promise. Emptiness can do this when it's viewed as an abyss or nothingness, a dark, infinite void that sucks hope dry. Some confuse the emptiness of Holy Saturday with the emptiness of Easter Sunday and think, this is ground zero, emptiness and space with nothing left to do or say, or think. fear comes. Perhaps because they never believed the word of Jesus in the first place. So the empty tomb comes as quite a surprise. They weren't ready for this new day, but they can't press the snooze button and stop it, not even for a moment. If Jesus was still in the tomb, that would have made more sense to them. An empty tomb, however, means the future is still open. Yet deep down, perhaps they didn't believe it. Maybe we don't believe it. Even when a new day dawns, even when all signs point to it. Perhaps those in Matthew's gospel pictured the future as crucified people being laid in tombs forever. Through this perspective, the tombs would never be empty, only full of very dry bones. The presence of fear, so prominent in our lives, can become, as author Carolyn Coleman writes, it can become so settled inside us that we don't even know what living feels like without it. That must be the thing about fear, the trick of it, that we forget that that's what it is, because it just starts to feel like our lives. Thinking that life is just an eternal emptiness will do this, and we'll want to be like the guards and become like dead men and women. An empty tomb, for some, is seen as death because there appears to be no content in what should be a hopeful future. It appears that there's only nothingness there. But early on Easter morning, on the day of resurrection, we discover there is something there. Like at Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and at his death, there's an earthquake to shake up the world and the way we think and the way we act. This Easter day, the lightning of an angel should show us that nothing remains as it was. The resurrection destroys the status quo because, as one commentator notes, to meet Jesus in this way is for the ground to move beneath you. We can't meet the resurrected Christ without being shaken by his presence. It's when things are empty, like an empty tomb or an empty life, that we will meet Jesus as we go, just like the women in the story did. Someone might say, well, my life is empty. That's when Jesus can fill it. If the tomb wasn't empty, we would only know a dead Jesus. And a living Jesus is so much more important and interesting than a dead one. The angelic movement of this day should shake us into seeing emptiness in a new way. For in this account, we can see the resurrection in a different perspective, in which emptiness does not mean nothingness and darkness. In Christ, through the resurrection, emptiness is fullness. It's somethingness. As I said before, an empty tomb means the future is still open. Fear can cloud our vision, and it's a part of the human condition, but it's also a part of Christian theological traditions. Surrounding good news often is the encouragement, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you will name him John. Don't be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and you will give birth to a son and name him Jesus. Don't be afraid, shepherds. I bring you good news of great joy for all people. Don't be afraid, the angels and Jesus tell the women. Literally, the angel says, stop being afraid and keep not being afraid. Through the resurrection of Jesus, We can see that even fear isn't ultimately fatal, because the world looks different through an empty tomb. And if we can handle the darkness of a tomb and of a dawn, there's nothing to fear going forward. As a proverb declares, fear and courage are brothers, which means fear doesn't have to control or stifle our lives. Actually, the empty tomb can be a source of great joy, but it takes courage to face the empty tomb and do as the angel urges. Come. Come and see the place where he lay. The women that morning, they possessed fear, but they also had great joy as they anticipated accepting the angel's invitation to come and see where he lay. This invitation to come and see the place where he lay is extended also to each of us, and it's an invitation to experience the empty tomb that signifies a full future in God. The empty tomb signifies a bright future through the frame of the resurrection. It's an invitation to enter the open door of God, to walk into the future God has for us, not knowing what's next, not knowing where is next, but assured of who is next: Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. To enter the empty tomb is to experience the vision of an open future for each of us and for our world. To learn that the stone hasn't been rolled over our future, but it has been removed from it, assuring us that we have one. The women come into the tomb to go out on a mission. The stone was rolled away to let the witnesses into the resurrection life of Christ. And through Christ's absence in the emptiness of the tomb, we can experience his presence with each of us today. So the Easter earthquake cracks open a new understanding of emptiness. Emptiness, not as negation or nothingness, but emptiness as somethingness. Emptiness. An empty tomb means that the possibilities for life are open forever. Emptiness. An empty tomb as something that can be filled is a call to fill it with our gifts, with our talents, and with our time. An empty tomb is a clean slate, a new beginning. An empty tomb, an open tomb, is an openness to the unexpected, an openness to be filled. So when the earthquake hits on Easter morning, emptiness is changed forever. When the earthquake hits on Easter morning, we gain something. We gain new life and hope. We gain a future of joy, all because of an empty tomb. With emptiness, some think nothing is there, but something is there. The hope of our future together, that one day we will all be resurrected and made eternally alive. What was deemed nothing is something beyond our wildest dreams, because emptiness is full of potential in the resurrected life of Christ. Just as a caterpillar's present existence is defined by its future as a butterfly, our present existence is defined by the future that God has for each of us. An empty tomb is a womb of new birth, a future waiting to be born. But we have to enter it to receive our charge for our mission, to go and tell. Come, come and see the place where he lay. For the empty tomb is a call to fill the world with the resurrected life of Christ. To go and to tell, because the resurrection draws us away from ourselves, away from the tombs of indifference and inactivity, and opens pathways to action, freeing us to move and speak and worship Jesus at his feet. We can worship and work because of the joy of the resurrection, because the tomb is empty. The tomb is empty, but our future isn't. Do not be afraid. He is not here, for he has been raised. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. On this Easter day, we give thanks to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. When we are gathered together in worship, we always set aside time to recognize the opportunity that we have to bring a portion of those gifts that God has entrusted to us and bring them back to work for his purposes, to work for the coming of his kingdom. And so today we also recognize that even though we're not gathered together, we have the opportunity as a community of faith to bring our offering. And so we come today dedicating our gift to God. And I invite you to join me as we pray together. Dear God, receive the gifts of our hands and hearts offered for your service. In the name of the risen Christ. Amen. part of our tradition in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, each time we worship, we come to the Lord's table to accept his invitation to share in the bread and the cup, representing his broken body and his shed blood. And although we are not together today, but we are spiritually together, we are one in Christ. And as we come to our own communion table today, we do so as part of the one body. When we come and accept Christ's invitation, we do so in an act of remembrance. For we remember Jesus' life and his ministry. We recall the sacrifice that he made for each of us on the cross. And we come to celebrate the resurrection, and what better time to do that than on Easter Sunday? To celebrate the resurrection that brings us into a new covenant with God, that promises us forgiveness of sin and life everlasting. And so again today, we come to be in the presence of the living Christ as we participate in this holy meal. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we are thankful that even in trying times, we have the opportunity to come to the table, to share in the bread and the cup. Today we ask that you bless these emblems so that for us they become holy, so that for us as we partake, they renew us and strengthen us and continue to equip us for a life of service as shown to us through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, for this is my body broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." I invite you now to partake of the bread, for we know that this bread is the bread of life. And in the same way also, he took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he shared it with his disciples, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And I invite you now to share and partake of the cup of salvation. Let us pray. O God, we are thankful. We're thankful for this opportunity, even in times when we are not physically together, to be joined by the Spirit of Christ as we have shared partaking of the bread and the cup. For we know that you continue to dwell within us and among us, and through the partaking of these emblems, we're made new and made one with the Spirit of your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now let us receive a benediction. Go in peace, love and care for one another in the name of Christ. And may God be gracious to you. May Christ's living truth guide you in the path of eternal life. And may the Holy Spirit fill you with hope and joy, this both now and forever. Amen. Thank you.